In the 19th century, the Manchu Empire didn't feel it needed Tibet's intervention with the Mongolians so much, because the Mongolians had become really quite pacified by that time and very monasticized. And they also were having a bit of a mass monastic society, not as much as Tibet, but quite a lot. So then the Manchus were not so interested in treating the Tibetans that well. And a bunch of Manchu ambassadors in Tibet and some corrupt Tibetan sort of Lama politicians, between them, they conspired that between the 9th and the 12th Dalai Lamas, they didn't come to their majority, and therefore they didn't really exercise the power of the office of the combined, you know, spiritual and political office of the Dalai Lama. But luckily, the great 13th Dalai Lama, born 1876 and living till 1933, he began the process of connecting to the world the Tibetan culture and its millennial consciousness in the people by first fleeing the British invasion of 1904. And the British invaded because the Tibetans wouldn't answer their letters about trade and things like that, because the Tibetans, and they wouldn't, the Chinese kept telling them that we're telling the Tibetans to correspond with you, but they would refuse to do it, the Tibetans, showing that they were not ruled actually by the Manchus at all. And so the British decided they themselves better go invade and they better make a relationship with the obviously independent Tibet. And so they went in there, and the Dalai Lama fled in 1904. And he lived in Mongolia and China, where he met all sorts of ambassadors, and he got to know, rode in railroad trains, and he got to see modern industrial activity, motor cars and things like that. And he realized sort of the nature of the late imperialist movement and also the nation state movement. He then went to China too, but in China, the Dowager Empress at the very, very end of the Manchu Empire, just when she was at the end of her life too, she was very annoyed with him when he wouldn't kowtow to her, because he said, our relationship is not like that. You don't rule Tibet or me. You are my patron, Dharma patron, you know, Buddhist patron, and I'm your teacher. So in a way, you should bow to me. They had like a little thing like that, which the earlier Manchu emperors had done in the 17th century and 18th century. But she was not buying that at all, because she just didn't care about Tibet at that point. And she was about to lose everything, in fact. And so then she ordered a general to pursue the Dalai Lama and kill him, actually, in 1989. And he fled back to Tibet. And then in 1910, he fled from Tibet into the arms of the British in India, who he had originally escaped from, got to know them and became great friends of Sir Charles Bell, who was the British plenipotentiary for the Himalayas, and who helped him, you know, with negotiating with the British Empire. Although he was frustrated because the British wouldn't really help Tibet, because they were more interested in business with China even then, the way it's been today, you know. Anyway, when he returned, then the Manchu Empire collapsed in 1911, and the Dalai Lama returned to Tibet in 1912-13 winter. And in 1913, he declared Tibet's independence in a modern sense, as a modern nation. He made a fabulous flag, combining an old war flag of two snow lions, plus holding up the three jewels of Buddhism, plus some rays of sun and everything, quite a pretty and colorful flag. He upgraded the parliament that the Dalai Lama, fifth Dalai Lama, had created in the 17th century. He abolished capital punishment. He wrote a national anthem, opened a postal service, printed stamps, made an independent treaty with the British and the nationalist Chinese, which was not ratified by the nationalist Chinese, so they didn't get the benefit of the treaty, actually, according to the language of it. But the British, by making the treaty independently with the Tibetan government, actually did recognize the Tibetan government in the Simla Convention of 1913, which later, today, British diplomats will deny that and act like they don't want. We don't know what you're talking about type of thing, in typical diplomatic kind of whatever, in order to do business, of course, you know, which was even the motive back then. And later, but at that time, he was also recognized by Nepal and Mongolia, which were both sovereign nations. He tried to form a modern army with minimal or grudging help from the British. And actually, the young Winston Churchill in 1923, and I once saw a letter in the East India Library on the embankment where he signed this letter in 1923 to the Governor General of India, refusing to introduce an independent Tibet to the League of Nations, although he admitted in the letter that they knew perfectly well Tibet was independent. But he said that nobody will ever go there anyway. It's a godforsaken high altitude place. Nobody ever wants to go. So we don't need to defend it. And it's better when we deal with the Chinese in Hong Kong and we make money there. Or the Taipans don't want to have it recognized because they like to tell the Chinese that they partners that they do trade with that, oh yeah, you guys, Tibet is your playground, so we don't mess with it. And Winston Churchill himself, and that has had a big impact in what happened to Tibet in the 20th century, actually. Anyway, never mind that problem. In 1933, the great 13th got depressed and discouraged because he noticed how the communists destroyed Mongolian Buddhism and the Buddhist Mongolian culture, mass monastic culture. Russian and Mongolian communists destroyed it totally in the early 30s. And he recognized that this would happen to Tibet, although then it would come from China. He already knew about the formation of the Communist Party in China by that time. And so he exercised his psychonaut yogic power, and he consciously ceased to breathe in the middle of a ritual. And he told people, I'm leaving the body now because you are all going to have a horrible time in a couple of decades. And I want to be there grown up again in a new body in my next incarnation to defend you. And then this was not that surprising. The Tibetans, of course, rushed to try to convince him not to. But they knew that this could be done because of the type of things that we discussed in Tantra, where the psychonaut yogi or yogini withdraws their energies into the central nervous system, leaves the coarse body, as they call it, sitting in clear light and maintaining like a kind of hibernating state, and then goes out in a subtle body and does different things in the universe, and then returns to the body, but also can just leave the body and then be reincarnated in a new body, which is what the 13th Dalai Lama did. And that's what the Tibetans at least believe. And it was very lucky because, in fact, in 1950, when the Chinese did invade, he was 15 years old in his new body, and he was able to do something to help them. His 14th reincarnation then was duly reborn in 1935. And as I have observed the situation over the years, I marvel at the fact, either because he did consciously reincarnate very geographically, geopolitically, or because, you know, the Tibetan government chose someone at that place. But where he was reborn is right on the edge of the high plateau, at the physical border between cultural Tibet and cultural China, right around the 10,000-foot mark in northeast, what is called northeast Tibet, Amdo, and what nowadays is called Qinghai by a province of China, of western China. He was brought to Lhasa after some complications and enthroned in 1940, the year of the Iron Dragon, and monastically educated from then on. He was only 15 and his education incomplete in 1950, which was 1 year after Mao, you know, stood up, as he said, you know, the 600 million Chinese finally stood up with the communist victory in 1949. And one of Mao's first preoccupations, in fact, was to capture Tibet and incorporate Tibet in the new empire, of course, to liberate them from feudalism is the idea, just like he was liberating everything else from, you know, we're going to liberate the whole planet, right? The communist international idea. And so it took him a year to get his generals to be willing to invade Tibet, who were tired of fighting the nationalists, you know, Chiang Kai-shek, and who didn't want to start another war and definitely didn't want to march up into that high altitude area. So it took him a year to force them all to do it. And he put Deng Xiaoping, who later became famous after Mao died, Deng Xiaoping was in charge from the beginning of that campaign to acquire Tibet for the motherland. So anyway, when the Dalai Lama, only a teenager and hadn't finished his own studies, was asked to assume full political responsibility, he did so in order to deal with the Chinese invasion. And then his government administration promptly traveled to the southern border of Tibet, bordering Bhutan, India, Sikkim, actually, and 1951 to avoid the Chinese army's entry into central Tibet, because they didn't go into central Tibet right away. They defeated the ragtag sort of Tibetan attempt at an army in eastern Tibet in 1950, but then they waited and they made a pretense of a treaty and they did all kinds of things, 17-point agreement, what it's called, and then they weren't sure they would be able right away just to go in and grab central Tibet. But the Tibetans were afraid they would, so the Dalai Lama went to the borders. His administration took him there. But then the young Dalai Lama asserted himself, and he refused to flee to India. He didn't believe that, you know, there would be a big liberation movement to defend Tibet from communist China, although there was one, he knew, at the very same time, beginning in Korea. It's the North and South Korea thing, what's going on. But he didn't really believe it, and he knew the Indians didn't want to really struggle with the Chinese over Tibet. So he felt it was much better to go and try to get along with the Chinese communists. After all, he himself felt there were some old-fashioned things about Tibet, and he thought maybe they'll help us fix it up. And, you know, he took them at their word, a little bit nervously, because he knew they were very anti-religious thing, and he knew what they'd done to Buddhism in China and Mongolia and so on. But still, he thought he'd give it a try. So he went back and he started dealing with the Chinese generals there and cabling back and forth to Mao. And then in 1954, against the wishes of his people, he actually went down to Beijing for 11 months. He was then traveled around China. And he got to know Mao pretty well, and Deng Xiaoping, and Zhou Enlai, he met quite often. And he especially hung out with a man called Xi Zhongxun, who was the father of the president Xi Jinping, who was the president for life of China at the moment. So he had a whole experience with the Chinese, which he talks about in all of his autobiographies. And he sometimes jokingly says when he's in the West that he was brainwashed and he became a Marxist. Because he likes the idea of social justice and so on. Of course, he doesn't like the violence. And once they started with the class struggle and beating up the so-called upper class, etc., you know, the Chinese were confused in Tibet because Tibet didn't have a highly stratified class system, big, huge, very wealthy landlords and merchants like they had in China. So they had to sort of manufacture and grab a few more wealthy peasants and nomads and say they're the upper classes, and then encourage some drunkards and beggars and defective type of people to go and beat them up and say we want our lift back, which resulted in the disaster of the farms all fell apart and the nomad herds became decimated, and more than decimated, they had famines. I mean, they really wrecked the place, you know. Anyway, out of their good, you know, communist ideological intention, they were trying to make it nice, but they imposed this in Tibet, which they didn't understand the culture of it at all, you know. Anyway, then he tried for these 8 years, from 1951 to 59, to get along with them, and in the meantime, finished his studies, passed his geisha degree, became sort of fully learned in an exoteric sense, and all the texts that he had to know, memorize them and everything. So by 1959, he was a graduate, sort of PhD, you know. And although he hadn't had time because of dealing with the politics and with the army and the disturbances that caused by having such a large people garrisoned around in Lhasa and in central Tibet, and with fighting going on in the east by the sort of unruly Tibetan cowboys of eastern Tibet, he didn't have time to do retreats or to really sort of deeply meditate about them in that first period. But anyway, then Mao and Deng, in 1959, became kind of annoyed with the whole process. And they were worried about the resist. They crushed a lot of resistance fighters who like went against machine guns with swords and things in eastern Tibet, and they crushed them eventually, although they took a big toll on them. And then they had fled into central Tibet, so they decided they would try to trap them all and create a revolution in the center of the country and get these resistance fighters in there under the guise of protecting the Dalai Lama from them, and then demolish all of them. So they put the Dalai Lama like a piece of cheese in the middle of Lhasa in some place, in a palace, summer palace that he lived in called the Norbalinka. And they lined up all their artillery, and then and a lot of the Tibetans from Lhasa came and massed around the Dalai Lama and wouldn't let him go to the Chinese military camp because they thought the Chinese would then disappear him. And they were hoping that the remaining fighters from eastern Tibet, who were armed and were armed and dangerous, they would also come in to protect the Dalai Lama, which luckily they didn't do. And then luckily the Dalai Lama escaped at the last minute through the Chinese lines and made his way to India, running away from Chinese pursuit with the help of those eastern Tibetan warriors. But just around the time he escaped, the Chinese were just trying to nip it in the bud and get whoever was gathered around the Dalai Lama's palace and blew them all up, actually, and would have killed the Dalai Lama if he had stayed. This has been recently beautifully written up by a wonderful Chinese scholar called Jiang Lin Li in a book called Tibet in Agony, Lhasa 1959, published by Harvard University Press, actually, marvelous work that shows just how manipulated the whole situation was in 1959 and how practically miraculous it was that the Dalai Lama escaped. Anyway, he made it to India. So once free under Nehru in India, the 24-year-old leader of a devastated people and a small refugee population set about the work of maintaining Tibetan Buddhistic culture in exile while attempting to speak out for his people in spite of being muzzled by world leaders who all felt, well, what they didn't know what to make of Red China, and they didn't like the communism, but they felt they should get along with them. The British in particular were still doing business through Hong Kong with the Red Chinese, in fact, and didn't want to ruffle feathers, even though they also were anti-communist. And Nehru thought that he and Mao in the 50s were going to be big buddies in the early 60s, and we're going to be sort of the new leaders of the big Asian giants waking up in the new UN and all international quarters, and they were going to really put an end to colonialism, et cetera, et cetera, and Mao and he would be partners. And unfortunately for him, Mao showed that he had no intention of palling with India, and he wanted to liberate India too when he attacked India in 1962, which was sort of which really broke Nehru's heart. But because of that, of Nehru's hope for that, when the Dalai Lama first arrived, he wouldn't really help the Dalai Lama externally and wouldn't send him to the UN, wouldn't vote for resolutions about the invasion of Tibet in the UN. They and the British all pretended they didn't know what was going on, and they believed the Chinese thing that it was an internal matter within China, which was supported actually by the Taiwanese, who had a seat in the UN at the time and who pretended they indeed owned Tibet. The nationalist Chinese in Taiwan did. So it just never really took traction, even though they were blocking Mao in Korea. Defending Tibet never became an international effort. And of course, the Russians were happy they were in Tibet. The Chinese, because they took a lot of gold out of Tibet, out of the cellars of the monasteries, and paid off big debts to Stalin with it, which has been also tracked by scholars since then. So that was this position that the young Dalai Lama found himself in, his encounter with modernity in the early 60s in a really difficult situation.